Silhouette 2024.5 introduces Mask ML, a single-click way to create masks to drive Matter Assist ML, creating animated alpha channels. My name's Ben Brownlee for Boris Effects. Let's dive in and see how it all works. We have our image here of a rhinoceros walking through the frame, and I'm going to use my new node, Mask ML. Now, Mask ML is a machine learning powered node that lets us create selections from a single click. So if I just click here, we create up our green dot, and it's then going to find the selection out of that. We can now feed that into our Matte Assist ML. Here we go. And just as we would do when we were using Easy Mask, I would recommend we use the data connection in here as well. Come down to the parameters in the Matte Assist and just change our reference frame from frame to keyframes. And you can see a full video of how the Matte Assist works in the tutorial link down below. So if I hit play on this, we're now getting a animated matte based off of that single Mask ML input. Now let's jump into our other shot and show you a different way of using this technique. And we have our image shot on green screen. Let's just turn on the Mask ML here. And I'll create a single dot on her face. And you can see that it hasn't selected all of the body this time, because, you know, maybe you just want to select the face or just want to select the skin. So this is where the tools on the left-hand side can be useful for us. So you can see we have three tools. We have a plus, a minus, and a rectangle. So the plus means we're in add mode. So if I left click down here, it's going to add to our selection. The minus tool is going to remove something from the selection. We might need a couple here. There we go. And let's just reset all of that down there. And we have a rectangular selection as well. So instead of just doing a little dot, I can click and drag and create up a rectangle there. Very nice. Well, let's reset that. Usually I will just have my tool always put into the plus category or the plus setting, because if I do want to minus anything, all I have to do is just right click and that will automatically drop in a minus dot there for me. Now, when we're using these tools, the mask that we're getting out of it, especially when we're dealing with the Matte Assist animated matte, is usually a little bit sort of smooth, let's say. So if we were trying to capture all of the sort of nice hair detail in here, this isn't going to be the best way to do it. Obviously, it's shot on green screen, so doing a Kia is going to be the best way of doing it. But a very useful and very common way of using these tools is to create a very, very quick garbage mask. So you can see that in this shot here, we have a little bit of stuff around the edges. It's not too bad, but it could be better. So we could go in, try and animate all of this stuff up. You know, if we have things moving around, we might have to do animated splines. All takes a little bit of time. With this, it's actually really easy. So let's show you how to do this. I'm going to come in, I'm going to use a Matte Assist ML again, and this will, as we can see, create up a nice animated mask for us. But if you look at the hair detail, you know, sometimes we're missing a little bit of the hair there. I'm going to add a blur into this, and I'm going to go channel blur. And the only blur that I want to do is in the alpha channel. So I'm going to set my blur red, green, and blue to 0. And set my alpha blur to 100%. So now whenever I do a blur on here, we're only going to be blurring out the alpha. Now, this is useful for expanding out the alpha, but obviously it's blurring in both directions, so we want to have a hard mask for that. So what I'll do on this one is I will use another tool, which is usually found in the key category, and it's called alpha threshold. And there I'll just be expanding that in or out to the edges of the gray where I need it to be. And this is a nice way of just creating up an alpha channel here. One of the nice things about using Silhouette 2024.5 is that the UI remains active and responsive even when it's calculating out some of these larger, heavier filters. So you see down here, instead of locking things up when we come to the end, I can actually still be skipping around. And at some point, you'll also see down in the bottom right hand corner, it's going to give me a progress bar of what is happening on a particular node. So that's really nice. Okay, so to final thing on this one to make this a bit more useful. If I come in, I'm going to add in a color node in here. And I'm going to add in a composite. Let's put the color in the background. Let's put our green screen in the foreground. And now if we're in the color here, well, let's just pick the screen color, something fairly close, fairly green. And now we have a very quick garbage mask created that we can then go in and finish up our key, which is exactly what we've got in this finish tree. While waiting here, I'll just show you that we do also have the progress bars happening on inside of the nodes as well. So you can see that something is actually happening. It's not just paused on these slightly heavier nodes. Hopefully you can see that this is a really nice alternative to spending lots of time hand animating garbage masks when we're trying to do keying. And actually, here's an underused trick as well. Once we've got this setup created for us, we can select the nodes that we want to use again. And I can just come up to the top here and save those nodes out. And this is just saved as a simple SFX nodes file. And if I come back to the original shot here, I can just come up and load those files in. And that will pop that in there for me. And I've got a nice base to work with when I want to do the rest of my keying. And I'm a big proponent of, you know, saving time wherever possible. Let's take a look at our next shot now, and I'll show you how we can get faster and more accurate results with our mask ML node. And you can see that I've had to add in a few points to try to get that as accurate as possible. What we can do to speed things up is actually limit the size of the frame. And we do that with a DOD node. So a domain of definition node. And we can find that in the transform. And I'll put that in before we even do the mask ML. We're not cropping the image, even though it looks like we're cropping the image. We're not actually cropping the image. What we're doing is we're just limiting it for this certain amount of time. At any point lower down the tree, we can open this back up again. Now, one thing is the DOD cannot be animated as we go through. So what we want to do, if we want to get this as efficient as possible, is to create something up, a sort of rough area, and then maybe come to the end frame here and open it up. So we're definitely sure we've only got the pixels that we need. So we end up with something on this shot that looks a little bit like a snake. What we don't want to do is we don't want to limit this too much and cut out anything that we actually need at any point during the playback. So that's pretty good there. Let's come over to my mask ML again. And we can see if I turn the DOD on and off, we're getting slightly different results. And we can see here around the fingers here where we've got, you know, small gaps. With the DOD off, those gaps get closed in. And with the DOD on, we're much more likely to get some of those details in here. Now, because we're dealing with a smaller frame, there's obviously not as many pixels to worry about. So we are going to get time savings. Now, on a single frame, like we're processing out with the mask ML, those time savings are going to be negligible. But actually, if we take this a bit further down with something like the mask assist over here, this is where we can start to, you know, maybe save a little bit more time. So if I turn the DOD off, let's come to the final frame. So now what I'm doing is I'm forcing it to not just calculate the mask ML at several different frames. I'm also getting it to cash in all of the mat assist ML as well. And that takes around about 10,496, about 10 and a half seconds. Let's do the same thing over here. So I'll turn my DOD back on and come to the final frame. And now that whole render takes about 4 seconds instead. So there's significant time savings we've got. And the results that we get are also going to be a little bit clearer as well. So you'll see me using DODs quite frequently when I'm working with this on projects or tutorials. So yeah, that's a great time saver and a great way of getting more accuracy. Let's come back to our Rhino shot now, because I'm going to show you a hidden detail that's often missing when we use these automated mat assist techniques, and that is motion blur. If we take a look at the alpha channel on this now, let's just come straight into the alpha. You can see that the alpha that's produced by the mat assist ML node is actually pretty smooth. It's almost like a binary map. There's a little bit of anti-aliasing here, but it doesn't have any of that motion blur that you have in the original movement. Now, there's a couple of different ways we can handle this, but all of them are powered by one of the newer nodes that we've had, which is Optical Flow ML, another machine learning node. So I'm just going to pipe my mat assist directly into the optical flow here. And you can see that we have the motion vectors being generated there. And we can have a little look at forward vectors, reverse vectors, and colorized vectors. And you can see a full tutorial about optical flow in the video up here, over there, definitely in the description below. Now, the optical flow in and of itself isn't that particularly useful, but it does provide us this flow data, which I can put into a brand new motion blur node. So this is available with Silhouette 2024.5 and above, and it has two inputs. It has our image input and it has our flow input. From that, we can just generate up motion blur through those motion vectors. Yeah, so it blurs out the original source as well as the alpha channel. So if we only want the alpha channel from this, what we can do, let's just actually add in another node. And this is a copy node. So we have our target being the mat assist. So that's going to be our, actually we could even have it coming straight from the source. We just need the color channels coming through. Doesn't really matter what we do. And then we have the motion blur coming in as well. So let's just tidy that up a little bit so you can see what's happening. And then we have the motion blur coming into the copy, and all we have to do is copy the alpha channel from the motion blur there, and we now get our motion blurred alpha channel coming through. Very nice. Now, one of the things to note is that the motion blur we get using this method might not be 100% perfect. In this example, it's pretty good, but it's not always there. So what I want to do is I want to show you a different way of achieving a slightly different motion blurred look. And if we come in here, I'll just copy these first three nodes and create a new little branch over here. So the difference here is that when we add in that optical flow ML node, we don't connect it straight to the mat assist to generate the optical flow from the color channels. What we do is we add in another node here, which is called alpha to color. And this gives us our black and white alpha channel. And we feed that into the optical flow instead. And this gives us a slightly different set of motion vectors than we had previously. Everything else is the same. So coming out here, we set up a motion blur filter that we add into here and into here. And this is definitely now blurring out. Kind of nice. And then we do our copy one more time. We'll take that over from here. Let's just move this over on this branch. There we go. Yeah, so we'll take the copy there. And again, with the alpha channel, we can now take that from the alpha of the motion blur. And let's just compare and contrast. I'll take a snapshot of the one that is using the color channels. And we'll compare that to the alpha to color. So to see the difference can be a bit slight, but there is a difference, and you might want to experiment with which one works out better for you. So let's see how that looks on gray. I hit A again to toggle the overlays, and let's just play back on that. And I'd also recommend, if you're doing this more than once, that you save these nodes out as a template, just so that all we have to do is just to connect things up and create that original mask, and everything else will just kind of cascade in. It's much, much easier, much, much faster. And there we go. That's how we can leverage the mask ML to generate up a alpha channel that we can then feed into the matte assist ML, using that either to create a finished alpha channel or using it to create an alpha channel that you're going to then work on, maybe as a garbage mask, for example. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris Effects. If you want to learn more about Silhouette, or actually watch those videos that I've been referencing throughout this tutorial, then of course head over to boriseffects.com for more details. If there is something you'd like to see us talk about a bit more in Silhouette, then just leave us a comment down below.